Behold, my patch of landeth. Look at how beautiful. Who would like to rent this and give me some moolah? Me lord, I have some money. Can I rent this land? And basically, my friend, that is the history of wealth in the game of real estate. In fact, from the beginning of time, land and property have been used as the core way for nobility to build wealth. And maybe it's time for you today to get a little history lesson and learn how to join the ranks.
One shot, now the future is yours. Go. I'm turning dreams into reality. Yeah. It's one shot, now the future is yours. Go.
On this channel, we're all about the real estate, and today we're talking about ancient property and basically the history of real estate. And it's important for you to understand that if you want to build real wealth, you have to figure out how wealth has been built through time. Speaking of which, for my birthday last year, my wife purchased 5 square feet of land in Northern Ireland. And you know that in Ireland, that makes you a laird or a lord. So technically, I have joined nobility.
A new diamond ring, high society. Dining like a king, oh.
I remember when my very first mentor in the game of real estate sat me down. You know what he said? He said, you know, Chris, real estate isn't rocket science. And I remember thinking, why does he keep saying that? What does he mean that it's not rocket science? What he was really saying is that real estate done correctly is actually really simple. It's a simple way to build wealth. And on top of that, did you know that real estate isn't new? Like, it has been around for a really long time. In the next couple of minutes, I'm gonna help you get an appreciation for how wealth has always been built. From Investopedia, real estate is as ancient as the formation of human civilization and has always been the primary way of building wealth, security, and prosperity. And I'm going to take you right now through the evolution of what real estate has undergone to get to the point where it's something that you can privately own and change your own financial stars. All right, are you ready? School is in session. We first got to start with the nomads. For almost half of human history, our nomadic ancestors followed their prey from area to area. They left little behind and never settled in permanent dwellings. I gotta tell you, I felt a little bit like this on a recent trip last year to Alaska. There was this sheep high up in the mountains that I was going for. This was a hunting trip. And for any of you freaking out right now, this is a way that I provide ethical meat for my family. But let's get back to the story. I'm going through 80,000 calories over 10 days to find the sheep. And on the 10th day of the last day of the hunt, I finally found my guy. It was a crazy cross shot over canyon. And at the end of the day, I found myself literally kneeling and crying that I'd finally caught this animal. The nomadic way of life was a very hard way of life. And all I really wanted was to go home. And the nomads, I think they eventually evolved to a place where they said, I would like to create a permanent home as well. The nomads eventually settled and they developed more of an agrarian approach to life. It was no longer like meat being the only protein source. They learned how to cultivate the land. The transition to agriculture also marked the advent of home ownership, a system of tribal leaders that they developed. Of those who had the approval of the tribe, they would disperse the lands, they would settle disputes and require payment from all of their subjects. Basically, land was awarded to the wise people. It was awarded to the individuals that were basically helping grow the tribe, grow the culture. And so real estate wasn't made available to everyone at this point yet. There's an ancient word that we use every day today in the game of real estate. It's called the landlord. This is the person that owns the property and they make it available for someone to rent. And guess what? This goes back to the landlord or the lord of the land. This is the lord that basically says, I own all this land, peasants.
The peasant at the diner. He didn't pay his check.
And I'm gonna let you give me some money if you wanna rent some of it. Check it out. As communities grew, a local army could defend from outside threats. In return for the security, the people all paid homage to the lord or king who claimed ownership of that land. This, in essence, was the first system of rent. So who are these lord of the lands, these landlords? These were the rich and powerful families that basically had taken over the land, or maybe they had armies that took it by force, but they basically claimed it. Land ownership was power. And then what they do is they'd let their people settle on it, and then they would have to give them of their grain or their storehouses or their goats or whatever formal payments of money that they used at those times. And this is the beginning where the people realized he who owns the land holds the power. I've got the power. This takes us directly into feudalism. Royal families spread their wealth to friends, signing away titles and deeds to lands that allowed the holders to collect the revenues, the rent, produced by the peasants living there. Rich merchants became the first common board landlords, gaining wealth and status. These merchants didn't own the land, but they did own the houses on it. And so, listen, the king wouldn't give you all of the real estate. They'd say, you can own what you put on it. The land is bottom line going to be mine. Is that very different than how it is, for example, in the United States? I mean, even if I have my house paid off free and clear, even if I have my land paid off, I still have to pay this thing every year to the government called taxes. That's part of feudalism. The system of feudalism ultimately gave individuals the right to rise. It gave certain people an opportunity to make more of their life. And bottom line is it came down to real estate. Listen, the greater you grew, the more wealth you had, it always came back to real estate. The people that owned the most real estate held the most power. And this system started to disseminate more and more of that power from the royals to everybody else. This system continued until basically people owned their own farms. And retirement was owning a farm, having a large family, hopefully having enough of the kids survive that they could take it over, take care of the parents. And real estate really was the original retirement plan. All of that changed with the Industrial Revolution. Many aristocracies were eventually displaced, and with the Industrial Revolution, the use of machines for manual labor freed many peasants from different tasks. People with ambition, not birthright, were finally able to jump classes and purchase property. This changed the playing field because it literally meant that anyone could rise up and create any life that they wanted for themselves, and in the majority of situations, it didn't come to, you know, owning industry. It didn't come down to owning business. It came down to owning and controlling real estate. To some extent, I'm a byproduct of the Industrial Revolution, right? I mean, my dad came from Germany to America, and he worked really hard to purchase 5 acres of land outside of the city of Redmond, Washington. And, you know, I grew up on that land, and that was all my father ever owned. And when I became an adult, I didn't inherit that land. That was my father's. If I wanted to create a future for myself, I was going to have to figure out how to eventually own real estate myself. But in this day and age, guess what's different? Most of us are now thinking with the Industrial Revolution, go work for somebody else because those companies would pay out pensions. This is the first time people also forfeited their heritage of real estate and basically said, I'm going to go work for a company in pensions. And they gave that up. And for me, I wanted to make a return to the game of real estate, which is why I buy a house just about every single day, because the more real estate I own, the more income I have, the more tax advantages I have. Ultimately, today, I have all of this real estate, and guess what it means? It means a lot of power. It means a lot of freedom. It means a lot of liberty. It means a lot of choice. The reason why this is so important for you to understand is because I rose not because of my family, not because of my relations or who I was connected to. I rose because I wanted to. If you're a subscriber to my channel, it's because you're here to figure out the game of money. And guess what? Money is nothing more than a game. It has rules. If you know the rules and you play the game, you can win. And a big part of playing for people that become very successful in life, it comes down to owning real estate. That brings us, my friend, to today. On the one hand, most of us are giving up our real estate birthright. Many people in this country don't even own real estate, and they certainly don't have an ambition of owning a lot of real estate. But you know what? There is this wild gap between the haves and the have-nots. And guess what the haves have? They own real estate. And I'm talking about more than just 5 square feet in Northern Ireland that might make you a laird on paper. But ultimately, what did it take for me to become financially free at an early age? At the age of 26, I had 25 properties. And those properties were assets that I controlled. Each one of those homes was bringing in about $500 a month of positive cash flow. Now, you can't retire on $500 a month, but if you do that 10 times, that's $5,000 a month. If you do that 20 times, that's $10,000 a month. When I had $12,000 a month coming in every month, whether I worked or not, by virtue of my real estate holdings, guess what it ultimately meant? Meant that I could quit my job and pursue the life that I wanted. Real estate ultimately bought me back. It unmortgaged my life. It gave me back my 40 work hours a week, and I could now live life on my terms. That is the history of real estate, and that's why you want to own it. It doesn't matter where you live in the world. Real estate will always be the core of building wealth. And if you don't have a foundation, a plan, a game plan, a map of how you're going to acquire it, then I want to give you mine for free. This book is called The Straight Path to Real Estate Wealth. You'll notice that it looks like it's spelled kind of funny, and it's based on a biblical verse that says there's a lot of crooked paths that bottom line lead to financial destruction. This book is about a singular path that I have helped tens of thousands of people use. Many of those have gone on to become self-made millionaires. And today that's my gift for you. If you don't have a path of leveraging real estate to control your own financial destiny, click the link below. You can get this book for free. You're gonna have to cover the shipping and handling, but otherwise my entire cost, print, everything, all the information in this book, I wanna give you all of this knowledge so that you can be empowered to leverage technology of the past from the beginning to build the life of your dreams. If thou desirest to build a real estate empire, then you're gonna need a team of five core people. And in this video, I'm gonna show you who those five people are, how you put them to work, and how they build your wealth. And guess what my wife did for my birthday? She bought 5 square feet of land in Ireland? Which country? Where is this?